From the mid-1950s to the late 60s, a critical part of U.S. history took place, the Civil Rights Movement. This was a time period in which many important figures emerged and strived to create a just society in which citizens had the right to political and social freedom and equality. The African Americans were the main victims of inequality at the time. They were discriminated against merely for their unique skin color. They were forced to drink out of different water fountains than whites and had to go to different institutions than whites and were forbidden to do certain activities. Many African Americans and Caucasians alike stood against the discrimination and led peaceful marches and protests and made groups whose goals were to get rid of this problem.
Yeah, not violence. I didn't see violence. But I knew, well, for example, B, the woman who worked for us, who loved her dearly, didn't drive. So if she was at our house late or whatever, we would drive her home. In order for us to drive her home, she had to sit in the back seat because the highway patrolmen were notoriously bigoted. And if I was driving and a black person was sitting next to me, they would think I was a Yankee instigator. And they would pull us over on some trumped up charge. So B would not sit in the, even if I said sit in the front seat, she would not do it because she didn't want us to get pulled over. I mean, there were just these things that were normal but not. There were things that you had to do.
Rosa Louise McCauley was born on February 4th, 1913. Both her parents were farmers who had separate jobs. Since she was a very ill child, Park's parents separated young, where she was then raised on her grandparents' farm with her mother and brother. Parks began attending schools at age 11, but her education was cut short when she left school at 16 to take care of her ailing grandmother. To support her family, Rosa Parks learned how to type and decided to sue. Parks married Raymond Parks, a barber, who was also active in the civil rights movement. With her husband's motivation, she joined the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and served as a secretary of the chapter in Montgomery, Alabama. Parks managed to help other African Americans pass the tests needed to register to vote. As her main job, she worked as a seamstress at the Montgomery department store and as a housekeeper for a family. Rosa is best known for her act of civil disobedience in December 1955, when she refused to give up her seat on the bus to a white man in Alabama. After her arrest, she was taken into custody and fined $14. This incident soon sparked a 13-month boycott of the buses in Montgomery and African American organized by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Although Park's arrest became of great importance nationally and historically, the aftermath had a very negative impact on her immediate life. She became dismissed from her job, she started receiving threats, and she became hassled. In 2004, Rosa Parks was diagnosed with progressive dementia and died the following year on October 24th, 2005. To honor her death, all the buses in Montgomery and Detroit reserved the black ribbons with her honor and remained this way until Rosa was put in her final
rest. May 19th, 1925 in Nebraska and is the son of Hurl and Louise Norton Little. His father was Hurl, a preacher and a member of the UNIA. His mother, Louise Norton Little, a strong woman who raised 8 children and instilled black pride in them. When Malcolm X was a child, his family was constantly harassed by the KKK, even though his father tried to stay away from these groups. Their house in Lansing was burnt down, causing them to move away. A while later, Malcolm's father was found dead, and the family thought he was killed by the Black Legion. After the death, Malcolm's mother was very melancholy and could not take care of the kids, so they were sent to foster families, where Malcolm went to a junior white high school. After becoming crestfallen because the teacher doubted him, Malcolm X dropped out of the school. Later, he moved to Boston. After stealing, he was sent to jail for 10 years, where his siblings visited him. During one visit, they told him about the NOI, a group who tried to help the blacks. In 1952, Malcolm changed his name from Malcolm Little to Malcolm X to honor his unknown family and forefathers. He became a follower of Muhammad and opened temples in several cities. He brought up the number of members to 40,000 people. Following JFK's death, Malcolm X said that JFK had it coming for him. Not only did this separate him from the rest of the black people, but it was the wrong thing to say as a response to the tragic death. Due to his mistake, Malcolm was silenced for 90 days. During the silencing, Malcolm chose to leave the group and created the Muslim Mosque to unite the blacks. MLK and Malcolm X had a lot of tension throughout the civil rights movement. Although they both had the same goal of making a just society, they had different ways of going about it. MLK believed that it would come with peace, while Malcolm X thought that violence was the way to obtain the goal. On February 21st, 1965, three men killed Malcolm X in the ballroom during one of his many speeches. People think that the killers were part of the NOI to show revenge.
Little Rock Nine were nine black high school students living in Little Rock, Arkansas, in 1957. They were the first black students allowed to attend a local high school in the South, Central High. This was allowed in America at this time because Oliver Brown, father to a third grader in the all-black school in Topeka, felt it was unfair that his daughter had to walk a dangerous path to reach her bus stop, so he took this issue to court. Brown lost this case, but sparked a revolution against the ruling of the Plessy v. Ferguson case, which ruled that separate but equal facilities were legal. On May 17, 1954, the Supreme Court unanimously ruled against the Plessy v. Ferguson case. The day before the Little Rock Nine started classes and integrated their new school, Arkansas Governor Orville Faubus ordered the Arkansas State's National Guard to block the Black Nine students' entrance to Central High for their safety. The governor insisted violence would break out if the Little Rock Nine were allowed to enter their school. After a federal judge ordered the Little Rock Nine to begin attending school, a mob of angry whites and the National Guard still blocked their path. When escorted by the police, the Little Rock Nine were only able to attend school for 3 short hours. Daisy Bates, a sort of mom to the African-American students, remained hopeful that the Little Rock Nine could and would integrate Central High School despite it seeming that most of Little Rock's white population was against them. On September 25, 1957, President Eisenhower finally took action. He sent United States paratroopers to guard the Little Rock Nine in school, and the African American students started school. The Little Rock Nine were finally able to go to school without being blocked. Thankfully, the Little Rock Nine made a huge impact on society and on Central High, and now have many African-American kids attending Central High without going through the same struggles. The Little Rock Nine's legacy has surpassed them, and in addition to an integrated Central High and other schools, the Little Rock Nine now have statues, so that their struggle is memorialized.
The Black Panther Party was founded in the mid-1960s by friends Bobby Seale and Huey Newton. Originally called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, the group was created to protect black communities from unfair acts by the police. When the party was first growing, it based itself on their 10-point program, a list of 10 demands and rules that the members of the party were supposed to promote, like having an immediate end to police brutality, the full employment of black people, and 8 other mostly reasonable requests. As the party was first growing up, publicity to help their cause became well known was extremely important. In 1966, after an article published by the New York Times, the TV companies CBS and ABC followed a story about the massive turnout of black voters in Alabama supporting a Black Panther Party slate, an event that really helped the Black Panther Party become well known. Another event that helped the party happened in May of the following year when a small group of party members led by Bobby Seale, the co-founder of the party, marched into the California State Legislature, fully armed because they were against a gun control bill that they saw as a direct attack on their party. This new publicity caught on, and soon the Black Panther Party had chapters in 48 states across America. The Black Panther Party soon started to make more and more survival programs, 35 in total, but the most famous and impactful one was the Free Breakfast for Children program. First launched in January of 1969, this program gave a free breakfast every morning before school to kids whose families could not afford one themselves. This program reached every single state with a chapter and made an impact on thousands of kids' lives. However, even though at first the party seemed to be gaining a lot of support, quickly things began to escalate to dangerous levels. Police violence and oppression began to become a major issue. On December 4th in 1968, at 4 o'clock in the morning, Chicago police broke into the Black Panther's Chicago apartment with the help of an FBI informant. The police officers were murdered Fred Hampton and Mark Clark in their sleep, and injured five others, including a pregnant wife of Fred. In total, 90 shots were fired, only one of which was from a Black Panther Party member. But the surviving party members were all arrested for attempted murder and aggravated assault, and no police officers were ever put in prison. Police violence isn't the only issue, though. Internal conflict and FBI discredit attempts hurt the movement as well. The FBI director at the time, J. Edgar Hoover, was afraid of the rise of black nationalist groups and used the counterintelligence program to try to degrade their image. Although it was used to hurt black national groups in general, the counterintelligence program directed 245 out of their 290 attacks at the Black Panther Party. Violence between party members were also a very real issue, and attacks within the group were not extremely rare either. Party member Alex Rackley was tortured and murdered by other members after being accused of informing the police about their party. In addition, the Black Panther bookkeeper, Betty Van Patter, was found beaten and dead, an attack that allegedly came from another member. Although the Black Panther Party eventually faded into dust, their legacy still lived on in other ways. A Vietnamese group used the name the Yellow Panthers and based their organization on the ideals of the Black Panthers. An oppressed minority in India expressed similar principles to that of the Panther Party, and even some Australian urban centers incorporated Black Panther ideals in their social movement of their own. Overall, the Black Panther Party was an influential movement in the civil rights era that fought police corruption and created opportunities for many young black Americans, but as time went on, became less and less relevant and faded into submission.
The March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom was planned by A. Philip Randolph and Bayard Rustin in 1963. They originally hoped to assemble 100,000 or more people at the Lincoln Memorial to support their goals. Those goals were to end segregation and protect people's voting rights. On August 28, 1963, Washington, D.C. hosted over 200,000 people of all colors to participate in this march. Civil rights leaders like John Lewis, Roy Wilkins, and Whitney Young gave speeches. As part of the day's event, Mahalia Jackson, Marian Anderson, Bob Dylan, and Joan Baez gave musical performances. Although all of those were great, the true highlight of the day was Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech, which was a passionate call for peace and equality. When he gave his speech, he stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, who 100 years earlier abolished slavery in the United States. Martin Luther King Jr. shared his vision in which,
"I have a dream. One day, this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created."
Another one of his very inspiring dreams was,
"I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character."
After the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, Martin Luther King Jr. and other civil rights leaders met with President John F. Kennedy to discuss civil rights legislation. The next year, the Civil Rights Act was passed, followed by the Voting Rights Act in 1965. The Civil Rights Act banned segregation on the basis of race, religion, or national origin in all public areas. These included courthouses, parks, restaurants, theaters, sports arenas, and hotels. It also banned race, religion, and national origin and gender discrimination. This created the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, which gave power to file lawsuits on behalf of poorly treated workers. The Civil Rights Act also prohibits the use of federal funds for any discriminatory program and allow the Office of Education to assist with school desegregation. The Voting Rights Act aimed to overcome legal barriers at the state and local levels that prevented African Americans from voting as guaranteed under the 15th Amendment. The 15th Amendment states, "The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude." The March on Washington was very successful because it pressured John F. Kennedy to sign these acts, which allowed African Americans to feel much more free.
Growing up, Martin Luther King was doing his marches and his speaking. Did you see the world change as he was, and the country change as he was doing those things?
I think the biggest change was the March on Washington. And the reason for me was, it wasn't, when there were people marching in Montgomery and people in Birmingham and doing what they were doing, it was primarily black people, a few white people. But the March on Washington that showed a real mix of humanity was a tremendous, I think, empowerment for people who may have thought, well, what can I do? You know, how am I going to get involved in this? And then it was evident that didn't matter what color you were, you could support what he was doing.
Yeah.